Hello friends, I'll be talking on this topic, phosphomycin. So this has been available for quite some time in our country. So I had reviewed this some time ago. So I thought I'll just revisit this and give a brief overview. So there was a recently extensive discussion on phosphomycin after I had done a presentation on biapenem. So we'll just review, give a brief overview for mainly all the trainees about this molecule. So this molecule came as a resurgence after we had all these escape organisms creating problem, and more so in the context of carbapenem resistant enterobacteriaceae. So this was sort of a revived and looked at repositioning its usage in CRE infections. So as we know, friends, once we have carbapenem resistant organisms or MDR organisms or XDR, some of the older drugs have been repurposed for its use. And phosphomycin also is a similar drug like colistin. So colistin came as a repurposed drug for MDR gram negative, and an extensive sort of utilization of this and studies on this happened between 2002 to 2015, realizing its potential for its usage in some of these MDR, XDR, and CRE infections. And at about same time, this phosphomycin also came about as being positioned more so for gram negative and gram positive. A lot of work has happened between 2006 to 2015, looking at this particular drug having any potential in its usage. So this is the context we have. So the difference of colistin is it predominantly works on gram negative, but phosphomycin has good effect on gram positive also. So that is something which is a little different. So when you look at phosphomycin, it is a phosphonic acid derivative, and this is the molecule name. So this is 1,2-epoxypropyl phosphonic acid. So the main backdrop of phosphomycin is oral phosphomycin, which is used as in a dose of 3 grams once a day, is extensively used by urologists, which we gathered very recently during one of the presentations that this is a drug which is used especially for all these MDR infections or resistant urinary tract infections. And this has been used in some of the GI infections also. So now the question is whether the IV formulation which has come now, whether it holds the same promise for treating these MDR infections in the urine or XDR infections, or is it useful for any other infections in the body? So that is where we are at. So when you look at mechanism of action of phosphomycin, like most antibiotics, phosphomycin has a role in inhibiting the cell wall synthesis. The key mechanism is there is a first step in the cell wall synthesis, which is a production of peptidoglycans. And that is where it inhibits the production of peptidoglycans. So it blocks the first stage of cell wall synthesis by inhibiting this UDP, N-acetyl glycosamine, enol pyruvate transferase. So this is the specific mechanism of action. By inhibiting this particular molecule, N-acetyl glucosamine enol pyruvate transferase, it blocks the production of peptidoglycans. And these peptidoglycans are the building blocks of the cell wall. So basically, it inhibits your cell wall production by blocking the first step in the formation of the cell wall. And that is where it is shown to be effective. So when you look at antimicrobial activity, as I said, the discussion on this came about when we are talking about the newer carbapenems. So again, this seemed to have good effect on gram positive and gram negative. As you see, it has effect on Staph aureus, epidermidis, and Enterococcus faecalis and faecium, which is a problem in our ICU because we have mixed infection. So we would have gram negative along with Enterococcus in intra-abdominal infections or even many times in urine also. And when it comes to gram negative, it tends to cover all the escape organisms: E. coli, Klebsiella, Serratia, Citrobacter, Enterobacter, and Proteus mirabilis. So all the escape organisms also is something that it would cover. But if you see here, it has there is no mention of Acinetobacter. So when you are considering phosphomycin, it seems to be good for predominantly the Klebsiella, E. coli, and Citrobacter species. So that is where we could possibly think of. And we know for sure in our country right now, we have good occurrence of CRE, CLEB, and CRE enterobacteriaceae, which is a problem, and E. coli also. So this is the spectrum we could think of, considering this drug when we have resistance to carbapenems. So let's look into some of the studies. So most studies, if you look at fosfomycin, comes from these Greek authors. So this was an article which came sometime in 2009. So clinical significance, pharmacokinetics, and characterization. So this reviewed the whole pharmacokinetics and dynamics of fosfomycin. So the conclusion they made was the pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic properties of fosfomycin reveals that it can have a good sort of a basis or substantiation for its usage in these infections. So when we look at PK/PD characteristics, which these authors have described in a detailed way, it is a very small molecule compared to a few other molecules, and it is hydrophilic. So it has a good binding and dissolves in the water. And it has a negligible protein binding, which means the free molecule is available for its effective action against the microbes. And when you look at the PK/PD, like most antibiotics, its action is dependent on the peak concentrations and time above MIC, which we discussed in the previous talk when we spoke about carbapenem. And like other antibiotics, this has a post-antibiotic effect, which means even when the drug levels comes below this MIC, so as you see, the effectiveness of any of these drugs, when we say it is above the MIC, it means it is effective at the peak concentration, and this we call it as area under curve. Even for this drug, even if the levels come below this MIC, it has an ability to suppress the further growth of these organisms. So that's what we call as post-antibiotic effect. So fosfomycin also seems to have the post-antibiotic effect. And there are no metabolic byproducts of this study, of this drug. And it is excreted in urine. So when we were discussing in the last talk as to its popularity amongst urologists, one of the reasons possibly is it remains in the urine. The urine therapeutic levels in the urine remains for more than 48 hours. So that is why possibly it is most effective in UTI. And that's why when we had a discussion, when we were talking about another newer molecule, biapenem, there was a lot of discussion with urologists where they tend to use this in oral formulation more. And the question that was asked is, why is it that lesser dose is good enough for UTIs, especially when given in oral formulation? Because the therapeutic levels of fosfomycin lasts in the urine for more than 48 hours, which means to say, because the concentrations are achieved at a high levels in urine, it may be a very good drug for the UTI. And that is possibly the reason why urologists like this drug, and they can, and that is the discussion that was generated in one of the recent meetings we had. And when you look at the PK/PD characteristics, fosfomycin has a good CSF penetration. So it has a good CSF levels. And it has a good lung penetration. You have a good drug levels in the lungs. And it is found to be good for all the heart valves. So there have been good tissue concentration found in the heart valves. It is present in most tissues and in the bone. Bone penetration is good. So this is the, so these are any infections in these areas, it seems to have good penetration and good effect. So that is about the distribution of this drug. So let's look, see, if you see this title of this article, it says use beyond urinary tract and GI infections. So when you look at IV fosfomycin, friends, I was surprised when we were reviewing this drug that this molecule has been available since 1971. Studies have been there. As I said, it's a repositioned drug. So there are 1,311 studies so far done in fosfomycin. So it is not something entirely new molecule that we are rediscovering. So there have been umpteen number of studies, and it seems to have good at least usage over course of many decades. And there are 62 studies that are reviewed in details, which has reviewed this molecule in detail, amongst which there are 31 cohort studies, 9 case series, and 17 case reports. So I'll just take you through some of the key studies which are relevant to our ICU, because these are all studies on OPD patients, on all the stable patients. So this was one big study where they looked at use of IV fosfomycin in combination with any of these drugs. So if you look at the whole literature, most of the studies, as you see, they've used fosfomycin in combination, because here we are talking about positioning of this drug in intensive care. So we are looking at using this drug in more resistant infections or life-threatening infections. So we have to bear in mind, it is always used in combination because it works excellently well with synergism with other antibiotics. So here, if you see, it has been used in combination with penicillin, cefotaxime, ceftriaxone, aminoglycoside, clindamycin, or quinolone. So these are all the agents with which it seems to have good success. But I'll show you the newer studies. So the cure was attained in 81% of the patients, and where source control was achieved in 200 patients. And they've even used phosphomycin as a surgical prophylaxis, and they've compared with other prophylaxis. So this was a meta-analysis with 4 randomized controlled trials, 1,212 patients, where phosphomycin had been used as a prophylaxis, and they found the infection rates was no different when compared with the other conventional prophylactic agents that were used. But as I said, this is possibly an older study where they've used as prophylaxis. But now the intent of this discussion is mainly from ICU perspective. This is just a backdrop as to how this drug has been studied in various conditions. So the relevance of today's talk, or what I'm talking, is more to do with our ICU infection. So we'll review about only resistant organisms. So whether phosphomycin holds promise in gram-negative resistant infections. It's not simple, straightforward gram-negative infection. So this was a very good article, again, came by the Greek authors, so which was published in American Journal of Microbiology. So if you look at this article, so they have put out the UCAST and the CLSI, they have given the effectiveness of phosphomycin, and they've given the levels at which it is effective. So if you see the MIC levels for some of the organisms, Enterobacteriaceae is less than 32. For E. coli and Enterococcus faecalis, it is less than 64. So those are the breakpoints they have given for effectiveness of this drug. So we'll just take you through some of the clinical studies. So this was one study which came in 2010, again by the Greek authors. As I said, most of these studies are done in the Mediterranean region. So this was intravenous phosphomycin for the treatment of nosocomial infection caused by CRE, carbapenem resistant Klebsiella, which is a problem in our country. So if you see here, it is a very small case series. It is 11 patients. And you see these patients are very sick. The Apache is 23 plus or minus 4, which means they had a reasonably high Apache score. And the type of infections, there are patients with bacteremia, VAP, and VAP with UTI. So which means they have positioned this drug against all sorts of infections in ICU. And just take a note on the dosage. So the dosage of phosphomycin for all the listeners, at the end of it, you will realize it is 4 grams up to 4th hourly you can give, which means 24 grams per day, or 4 grams 6th hourly, which means it comes to 16 grams per day. That is the dosage. Here, if you see the dosage, they have given 2 to 4 grams every 6th hour. So up to 16 grams they have given this drug. And they found the bacteriological and clinical recurrence. This is in carbapenem resistant, because we have the problem, and there are very limited drugs for carbapenem resistant Enterobacteriaceae or Klebsiella at this point of time. We have only ceftazidime, avibactam, or colistin. So phosphomycin is something one could keep in mind, because you see here bacteriological and clinical recovery happened in all patients, and none of them had relapse. Super infection did not happen in any, and hospital mortality was 2 out of 11 patients, and there was no serious adverse events. So that was the report of this study. So this was another study which came in 2012 by the French group. Again, this is predominantly looking at the resistant organisms. So here, if you see, they have taken 116 patients, and 44% were critically ill, which means there were sick patients with MDR infections. And if you see the type of infection here, they have again taken all sorts of infection, lung infection, bone infections, bacteremia. And if you see the dosage here, again, they're given 4 grams 4th hourly, which means, or 6th hourly, which means again 16 grams they've used. So you can give 16 grams to 24 grams is the dosage of phosphomycin for the listeners. And if you see the bottom one, combination was used in 100%. So again, that is something which a listener should bear in mind, that phosphomycin, the dosage is little different. You give a much higher dose more frequently, and it is always meant to be given in combination with other drugs. And the mortality in this particular study was 25.9%. And as you see, the favorable outcome was seen in many of these infections, bone and joint. And as you see, the bone penetration was good, lung penetration was good. See, if you see the urine, the response rate was 100%. So again, going on to reemphasize, because your therapeutic levels in the urine remains for more than 48 hours, this seems to be a reasonable drug, or a good drug, for CRE in the urine. So that is something one should keep in mind. And for bacteremia, it was less. As you see, 57.1% is the response. So that was about the second study, again from the Greek authors. So this was another study, again came from, as I said, most work is done by Greek authors. This is a study which came in International Journal, outcomes of critically ill intensive care unit patients treated with phosphomycin due to pan drug resistance and extensive drug resistant CRE. Again, this is for CRE, carbapenem resistant enterobacterium. So this was a multicentric prospective observational study done in 11 ICUs. So the median dose they've used, see here, if you see the dose they've used is fourth hourly, 4 grams fourth hourly comes to around 24 grams per day for 14 days. And again, here they've used in combination with colistin or tigecycline. And infections were bacteremia or ventilator associated pneumonia. And the organisms predominantly were XTR Klebsiella pneumonia or Pseudomonas aeruginosa. So they had 68 patients they evaluated. Day 14 outcome was 54.2%, but day 28 mortality was 37.5%. Bacterial eradication happened in more than half of the patients. Phosphomycin resistance was found to be in 3. So the adverse events, the subsequent slides you would see, the predominant adverse events noted when you're using this drug is hypokalemia. So that is something what one should keep in mind when you are treating with phosphomycin. Hypokalemia is something that tends to occur as a adverse effect. So as you see, severe hypokalemia happened in around 15.2%, and the lowest potassium value was 2.7 in their study. So that is something a listener should bear in mind when you are contemplating the usage of phosphomycin. So in fact, we have used the phosphomycin for our patient. I'll just take you through the one case study. So it was a 68-year-old male with CA sigmoid colon, who had a background of diabetic, hypertension, smoker with COPD and obesity. So he underwent partial colectomy with end-to-end anastomosis. So the surgical prophylaxis that was given was ceftriaxone 1.5 grams 8 hourly. Day 5, post-op, he developed VAP. He was intubated and ventilated. And he was on piperacillin tazobactam that was started empirically with vancomycin. Then DPT culture, which came, showed XTR Klebsiella pneumonia, which was resistant to colistin and resistant to meropenem. So this is a patient where we had to use a newer drug. So this was a little older case. So we did not have the newer antibiotic like ceftazidime, avibactam at that point of time. And it is resistant to colistin here. So there is the colistin is out of the choice or out of the option. So you have to have some drug. At that point of time, we only had phosphomycin. So at that point, we used phosphomycin 4 grams 6 hourly with colistin. Because as I said, this drug always is meant to be used along with another antibiotic because of the synergistic effect it has. And I'll show you the synergism study. And this patient nicely improved. We extubated and sent him home. So this was the time when the newer drugs like ceftazidime, avibactam, which is now very effective against the CREs, was unavailable. So we had to use this phosphomycin. So it is still a drug to be kept in armamentarium as one of the options when we are dealing with CRE. And as you see from the studies, it is most effective for urinary tract infections, and the response rates were found to be much better in the studies. So now let's look very closely into with what antibiotics this drug has a good synergism. So this was the synergistic studies. In fact, in the recent meeting we had, we did discuss about synergism and the importance. So this was a study, again, came from Greek authors, synergy of phosphomycin with carbapenems, colistin, aminoglycosides and tigecycline against MDR, Klebsiella pneumonia, E. coli and Pseudomonas. So that was the title. If you see here, see by per se, if you look at this Klebsiella pneumonia here, the sensitivity of this is only 21.5%, the sensitivity. But then if you added phosphomycin, you could see the sensitivity was 96.9%. And so was the case with E. coli, it was 100% and 93.3% with Pseudomonas. Mainly look at Klebsiella and Pseudomonas, because the sensitivity of only carbapenems was very less, but with phosphomycin it was 93.3% or achieved more than 90%. And this is again the groups where they have divided into combination with phosphomycin. If you see with combination with imipenem, the sensitivity went up to 75.4. So with all carbapenems, the synergism was found to be better, because you see with imipenem, meropenem and doripenem, the synergism was much more effective as compared to colistin. If you see colistin, it falls much lower. With aminoglycosides, it falls lower. And tigecycline also, it falls lower. So the synergism of this phosphomycin was found to be very good with carbapenems. And again, this is even above where organisms above MIC is above 8, the synergism was more than 74% effectiveness when combined with imipenem, meropenem, or doripenem. But it did not have a great synergism with polystyrene, aminoglycoside, or tigecycline. Although you saw a previous study where it was used in combination with colistin or tigecycline, and they had a good clinical. But when you look at synergistic studies, phosphomycin seems to have a good synergism with carbapenems. And in fact, when I put up my case study, that was possibly based on the previous study where they used colistin. With colistin, synergism is not the best. So when any of listeners would be using phosphomycin, it is desirable to use with among the carbapenems. And now we have a newer carbapenem like biapenem or meropenem is something one could consider. So when they look at the adverse events, as you see, acute kidney injury is very similar to other comparators and GI disorders. And so the death happened. So basically, there was no huge difference between the adverse events when you compare with other antibiotics that were used for MDR infections. So the side effect profile didn't look very different. So it was similar. And as I said, hypokalemia was a predominant side effects. 5% of them had hypokalemia. And mild elevation in the liver enzymes happened in 2%. And GI disorders, nausea, vomiting, which is common with most antibiotics, happened in 2%. Rash and few other usual side effects. So hypokalemia is something that listeners can bear in mind when you're using phosphomycin. So the key messages about phosphomycin, so the available clinical data as of now, as you see, the most data comes from the Greece. And we saw one study from the France, otherwise most data came from Greece, shows that it does hold promise as a useful drug and should be used as a reserve drug, mainly in XDR or PDR infections, where you have, especially in India, where we are seeing more of carbapenem resistant enterobacteria. So we could consider this as an option as a colistin sparing drug, if you do not, if there is contraindication or if you want to spare colistin or polymyxin B. So this drug is something that one could consider predominantly if you are looking at covering for CRE along with gram positive also, if you are having enter or if you are having UTI with a mixed polymicrobial infections and you want to hit both enterococcus and the Klebsiella pneumonia. But as you see throughout the discussion, there is no mention of Acinetobacter. So you have to possibly keep all the E. coli, Enterobacter, Klebsiella, Proteus mirabilis, all these in mind. So Acinetobacter, it may not be the great drug. And gram positives, it has a good effect against Enterococcus and Staphylococcus aureus. So, and it has to be used in combination. And the dosage for all the listeners is a very high dose, 4 grams, 4th hourly to 6th hourly. So which is 16 grams to 24 grams in divided doses is what is recommended. And always, as I mentioned, it has to be used in combination. So now we have reviewed the synergistic studies. It seems to have a best synergism with carbapenem. So now we have newer carbapenem. So possibly phosphomycin with a carbapenem, existing carbapenem or a newer carbapenem may be desirable in tackling our CREs. If you have to, or if you have a CRE which is resistant to colistin also, I think that is also a spectrum of patients where one could consider phosphomycin. And standardized MIC interpretate breakpoints for various species is lacking. So we do not, as you saw, there's only one slide I showed you with the breakpoints of less than 32 and less than 16 you saw. So there is not much data about newer breakpoints for this study, for this phosphomycin. So thank you very much. So you can visit my website, www.drpradeeprangappa.com, to rehear to this if you need to gain some clarity. Thank you all.